Ladies and gentlemen, we have the State of the Art Lectures Expanding Scope coming up. May I request the following gentlemen to kindly proceed forward and chair, Dr. H. K. Chopra, the President, Professor S. C. Manchanda, Professor Rick Levy, Dr. S. M. Kantikar, Ravi Kaslival, J. S. Soin and Nutan Agarwal. First speaker would be, can I invite Dr. Nitin Patankar from Mumbai to have his presentation, who is a senior consultant physician from Wisdom Clinic in Mumbai. Dr. Patankar, for the next 11 minutes to help you be on time, we have a timer straight across. And Dr. Patankar joins us to speak on obesity and cardiovascular disease. What are the facts? Dr. Patankar, please.
So, ladies and gentlemen, it's a very, very important session, because obesity is touching the epidemic proportions. As I mentioned, that in one of the presentations from Mayo Clinic, it mentioned that in obesity, 2,660% times higher diabetes. They also mentioned they are 400 times vulnerable to have hypertension and 360% is vulnerability for heart attacks, 90% vulnerability for gallstones, 100% vulnerability for cancer and osteoarthritis. So what is the disease left? Obesity has to be addressed. And we have a very important speaker, Nitin Patankar, who did tremendous work on obesity. Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Nitin Patankar to talk on obesity and CVD relationship.
Good morning all, and thank you very much, Dr. Chopra. I will be speaking in this line. The unfolding of this presentation will be a little bit on obesity development, then obesity and what is sick adipose tissue and what is the relation to inflammation. Then the link continues to have been inflammation and cardiovascular disorders. Then what can be done about it, the reversing inflammation and treating cardiovascular disorders, some practical tips which we use, and to sum up. So obesity is always thought to be because of genes. In rare instances, the genes produce significant obesity which cannot be controlled by a routine means, but there are 41 common genes which are permissive genes. That means your lifestyle choices allows the genes to express themselves to form obesity. Then two main defects promoted by permissive genes, and this is the beginning of all lifestyle disorders. One is muscle insulin resistance. So even after treating obesity, diabetes or lifestyle, the muscle insulin resistance still persists. So it is kept under control only and only by exercises. And second is liposusceptibility, that is percent of fat inside the different organs like pancreas, liver, kidney, which is required to disturb the function. In some people, a smaller percent of fat or adipose tissue may become sick. So this is how it begins. So we start with the left-hand corner, that is positive calorie balance. In presence of muscle insulin resistance and what we call as non-elastic fat cells or sick fat cells, you get increase in liver fat. That is the beginning, which causes increase in triglycerides, which spills over and causes increase in isolate cells, triglycerides, which can cause the cascade of diabetes. It also causes the suppression of hepatic glucose production, which is subdued or it is absent, and that leads to hyperinsulinemia, and that promotes liver fat further, and this cycle continues. At nutshell, it produces liver insulin resistance. It produces, as the fat cells keeps on expanding, it produces sick adipose tissue, and that leads to cardiovascular disorders. So what is the link between obesity and inflammation? So obesity induced inflammation accelerates atherosclerosis, and adipose tissue is recognized as a major player in obesity induced cardiovascular diseases. So adipocytes produce large number of hormones, peptides and other molecules that act by endocrine, paracrine and autocrine mechanisms. This leads to cytokine mediated inflammatory changes in liver, systemic inflammation and atherosclerosis. Then mechanisms of obesity induced inflammation. Basically, obesity produces systemic inflammation, either it's a low-grade inflammation or a severe-grade inflammation, as individuals become obese, adipocytes enlarge and proliferate. And this is not a healthy enlargement. More important is adipose tissue undergoes molecular and cellular alterations that subsequently lead to metabolism. So what happens in adipocytes? Basically, there are macrophage accumulation, there is local inflammation, pro-inflammatory factors produced like TNF-alpha, IL-6 and horde of others, increasing macrophages with increasing obesity scavenging for apoptotic adipocytes, and visceral fat has more number of cytokines and lead to more severe inflammation and atherosclerosis. Then there is an entity called as subclinical atherosclerosis. Raised levels of leptin from adipose tissue stimulate cholesterol uptake by macrophages. This is accelerated in presence of glucose. This triggers formation of foam cells and atheromatous lesions. So every obese patients won't have a sick adipose tissue. That is the genetic difference. So there is definitely an entity called as a metabolically healthy obese tissue. And in USA, there's a data is available that around 37.6% of obese people are metabolically healthy. So they don't have any other inflammatory changes present. So every obese patient need not be rigorously treated. So indicators of presence of inflammation, how we'll know? Now we know that the biochemical markers like CRP, then presence of ectopic fat, this is the bane of contention, which is most toxic, and other indicators. So ectopic fat assessment, how will you assess ectopic fat? Ectopic fat is not visceral fat. Ectopic fat is usually that lies in liver, in pancreas, in kidney, in skeletal muscle, in heart, and in peritoneum at the last site. So usually you can do a simple echocardiographic assessment, a pericardial fat and epicardial fat. And usually the epicardial fat is more than 7 millimeters, and that is an indicator that ectopic fat is present. And this is a histological section which shows that there is an epicardium and myocardium, there is no fascia separating. So fat that is lodged in epicardium usually traverses along the blood vessels into the myocardium, and there it can have all those autocrine, paracrine effects, and which causes the disturbance in function of endothelium, of the vessels, or a vessels altogether. Then this is a slide, this is the MRI pictures. There is something called the Dixon MRI, or three-point MRI, where the lower panel shows a hepatic fatty infiltration, while the upper panel shows that with 6 to 8 weeks of very low calorie diets had changed it, it comes back. So normally the hepatic fat is around 18 to 20%, and which can be brought down to around 6 to 8%, which is very healthy. Then this is a pancreatic fat. Again on left hand side there is a massive pancreatic fat around 8 to 10%, while on the right hand side after very low calorie diet treatment the pancreatic fat disappears. Similarly, we can measure something called the properitoneal fat, which is a very simple ultrasound measurement. A fat that is between a liver and diaphragm, there is a small triangle. The height of that triangle matches exactly with the amount of visceral fat. Then there is an endothelial dysfunction. These are the other indicators of inflammation. Normally, the brachial artery, if it's compressed for 5 minutes, and if you measure the dilatation post ischemia or post compression, usually it should be more than 20%. But in obese people with inflammation, the endothelium is affected. The shear related endothelium factors are absent, and that's why you don't get that kind of inflammation. Usually you can get paradoxical contraction also. So managing obesity with treatment for CVD, you don't have to manage only BMI or percentage of body fat, but managing ectopic fat is most important in management, and exercise as independent tool to manage muscle insulin resistance. So then question comes, is it worth treating obesity? Because everybody's experience is that if you treat obesity, it comes back. So is it worth treating? And there is evidence available. Ectopic fat can be managed by a few weeks of 600 to 800 calorie diets, and regular dietary management like 500 calories less than present and keep on reducing fat in a slow fashion doesn't allow that ectopic fat to go down. So what I was mentioning about is there is Cochrane evidence that people who don't lose weight but keep on attempting to lose weight, at 9 years of follow-up, there were 20% reduction in mortality just by attempting to lose weight but without having any weight loss. So that is the importance of trying to treat obesity or lifestyle disorders. Then recent experiment shows that 600 to 800 calorie diet, which follows principles of healthy diet, that is protein, vitamin content are maintained, don't lead to starvation. That is the first fear in everybody's mind. Balanced meal supplements are replacements from an integral part of such diets, and these diets are also used for halting diabetes progress. In liver transplant cases, to get normal hepatic fat, so a very low calorie diet also has got a role. So what are the anti-inflammatory effects? Meal supplements which used very low calorie diets helps in attaining goals along with reduction of inflammation. Use of omega-3 fatty acids are also useful in controlling inflammation. Then what are biochemical changes that can occur at a glance? We run a program called the Reversal of Diabetes Program. It is not cure, but patients can go off the medicines when their ectopic pancreatic fat and liver fat goes down a bit. So these are the reports I am showing just for one reason, that with very low calorie diets for 6 to 8 weeks, they don't have any deficiency. This person from 23.5 2015 to 8.8 2015, his hemoglobin remained from 14.8 to 14.6, but he lost around 16 kg of weight in that period. ESR was normal. Then the fasting sugars came from 218 to 84, postprandial from 270 to 105. And I will show you the triglyceride reports. Basically, the triglycerides came down from 118 to 47. Cholesterol came from 218 to 102. So with all the drugs that are used, this kind of a results are usually not seen even on short term. And if you look at the HbA1c levels, it came from 9.1 to 6.2. And we have got all 37 cases presently which have shown these results and maintaining it for more than 6 months. So to sum it up, all obesities are not same. So there is an entity called as a healthy obesity. Sick adipose tissue, that is to be tackled, and that leads to inflammation. Inflammation is a link between obesity and CVD. Ectopic fat modulates inflammation, and treating ectopic fat with VLCD and meal supplements leads to favorable changes in ectopic fat content and its outcomes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Patankar. You're well in time. I think there are still a few seconds left, but you give a very important message, ectopic fat. You use the word ectopic fat, and we are doing a series of studies of ectopic fat. Very, very important, lot of data. And I think you mentioned the cutoff point is 7 millimeters.
Yeah.
I think it's a very important. A lot of time we do an act. We must ensure that we measure the epicardial, besides the you see in the liver, but a lot of patients obesity. I have with me Dr. Kantikar. He is a pathologist and he holds a very important position in the Consumer Forum Court. So let us see what he has to see, as he say, as a pathologist about the obesity.
Thank you, sir. It is, Dr. Patankar told, the every obesity patient need not be vigorously treated. But as a pathologist, I feel every obese patient or person is very conscious about his health status, because it affects many of the tissues, and hyperlipidemia is the main concern. So he should be monitored meticulously, regularly, every time. And dietary habits certainly play a major role to control the obesity. Thank you, sir.
I wanted to say this obesity, it is not just important to prevent the obesity in the adult life. Now we say that there is a fetal origin of the adult disease. And even in the intrauterine life, the maternal conditions are very important to prevent the obesity in the adult. Because like if you don't control GDM, diabetes, these are the offspring which may develop diabetes, obesity and CVD later on in the life. So we have to start taking care from the intrauterine life itself, from the pregnancy.
So Nutan Agarwal is very specific that the obesity starts right in the utero. I can see the hand raised by Anita Khalil. What do you want to say, Anita?
I can make a comment. We usually start for obese, overweight patients, overweight pregnant girls. We allow them to gain only 8 kg weight with monitoring of USG dimensions of the baby, so that their diet is monitored and they don't gain more than 8 kg weight.
Yes, madam.
Throughout the
yes,
three trimesters.
There's a Anita? Very important hypothesis laid down by Professor David Barker, that the planning and the programming of cardiovascular health is laid down in utero. If the mother is malnourished, pregnant mother is malnourished, then the blood flow to the placenta and to the growing fetus is less. That leads on to fetal undernutrition. So thereby the arteries, fetal arteries are small, and that is what the cornerstone of hypertension in early adulthood. That leads on to what is known as metabolic syndrome. This is very, very widely researched, and I have been working on it in Indian infants who had grown small. There is a cohort laid down by Dr. Santosh Bhargav from Safdarjung Hospital. He collected something like 8,000 low birth weight infants. I am a part of that. It's known as a Sneha program. And those infants, 8,000 of them were collected from 69 to 73. And now we have a follow-up of something like 1,500 of them who are in their early 40s. And I have done their endothelial function and looked at their carotids. And I can tell you, I don't have the exact percentage now, as how many of them developed hypertension in early 30s and late 20s, how many of them have developed coronary artery disease, and so many of them are infertile with polycystic ovary syndromes. So this is a known fact, and this leads on to obesity very well so, because I have done the endothelial function studies and carotid studies of obese patients in 40s and how they develop huge carotid plaques, which leads on to sleep apnea syndrome. So this is something which we cannot disregard. It's a very, very well-known fact.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Anita Khalil. She was very, very focused, and she showed a huge data that obesity should not be underestimated. I think she is very specific in saying our focus is on a target organs when there is a damage taken place. It is a screening well in time of obese patient if you really want to reduce the morbidity and mortality. She spoke very well that even PCOD has got a very strong relationship. If we take care of obesity, we take care of so many things. That's a very nice message. You want to say anything, Rick?
Yes, recently in the United States, this is a behavioral question, sir. Recently in the United States, there were many headlines on obesity and weight loss that less than 1% of people were achieving the necessary weight loss to improve their health. I'm wondering what your compliance has been with your patients on these diet plans that you give them.
Dr. Manchanda, what's your viewpoint?
I think this is a very important topic because obesity is increasing in the developing countries. In India, it is really increasing. And in the public schools, we did some surveys that 25% of the children. And this is a big problem in the Western countries. But I think in India, we have more problem with the central obesity. And that visceral fat, just like you said, ectopic fat, is metabolically very, very active. And we have shown that if you use lifestyle, intensive lifestyle, including yoga, it can decrease central obesity and the inflammatory markers are markedly reduced.
I think Dr. Anita Khalil was very specific. She said that anybody has a longer waistline, there is a shorter heart line and a shorter brain line. That was a very nice message given by Anita. The second thing, I was very impressed by your one slide where you mentioned the role of hsCRP and the relationship with the metabolic syndrome. This has been documented and we published the data recently in our book, which is coming up last year, CSI Cardiology Update. hsCRP can be even graded, grade 1, 4, depending on the level of hsCRP. If it is more than 8, it is a morbid obesity. And 2 to 4 and 4 to 6 and 6 to 8, this is how we classified. I think there is a lot of role, and I'm really impressed to see there is so much of interest and so much of insight in the people's mind to learn about the obesity, because that's a real problem. Not only in the Western world, but also in the Eastern world, obesity is everywhere. Let's give a big hand to Dr. Patankar for the most outstanding presentation, which was very thought-provoking and a brainstorming session.